A very lovely good evening to all of you. I am Dr. Pooja, and today I am going to bring up a very interesting topic. Since I know tomorrow is your AIIMS exam and you people must be all geared up to give that exam. So this is a very small effort from my side. I have just, you know, made a certain slides on some of the important questions which can be asked in the AIIMS exam. So that before going for that, you just quickly go through my slides and you can just quickly revise this topic. So without wasting much time of yours, let's start with the questions. Now see, all of you know the pattern of the questions asked in the AIIMS exams. They are like assertion and reasoning based. So just read your question twice or thrice before attempting it. And you need to have a thorough knowledge about your subject also. So all of you know that there will be these options like that. Both assertion and reasons are independently true. And the reason is true, correct explanation for the assertion. Second option would be both assertion and reasoning are independently true, or the reason is not the true explanation. Or you can say assertion is true, but the reason is a false statement, or assertion is independently a false statement, but the reason is true, or both assertion and reasons are independently incorrect statements. So this will be the pattern of your options. Now, based on this, I have prepared certain questions which have been asked in the previous year of AIIMS exams only. So let's quickly go through these questions. Now, question number one is, hereditary fructose intolerance leads to the accumulation of fructose 6-phosphate, which is the cause for organomegaly, and reasoning is this is due to aldolase A deficiency. Now, before attempting this question, you have to just think about what is the metabolism of fructose. Right, how fructose is metabolized, because if we compare, you know, glucose and fructose, fructose always bypasses first step. And obviously there is a difference in the first step only. If glucose undergoes phosphorylation by glucose 6-phosphate, fructose undergoes phosphorylation by a specific fructokinase enzyme and forms fructose 1-phosphate. So obviously their metabolism is different. Then if we come over to this aldolase, if we see aldolase, this is an enzyme which belongs to lysis class, or this is a splitting up enzyme. So this aldolase actually splits up fructose into two intermediates. And one very interesting feature about this enzyme is this aldolase is of three main types: aldolase A, aldolase B, and aldolase C. Obviously, if the forms are different, the substrate would be different and their occurrence will be different. So if we talk about aldolase A, aldolase A is the enzyme in glycolysis. Aldolase B is the enzyme which is actually along the metabolism of fructose. So obviously, if you remember glycolysis, the substrate is fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. But here the substrate is fructose 1-phosphate. Right. And here in this fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Then another important difference is, since it is a glycolytic enzyme, so it will be present in all the tissues. If we see the occurrence of aldolase A, aldolase B is present in the liver as well as in the kidney. And aldolase C is present in the brain. Right? So you can see these are the major differences. Now, whenever we talk about hereditary fructose intolerance, it has nothing to do with this. It has nothing to do with this. So the enzyme would be different in this. Right? So let's quickly see the metabolism of fructose also. See, fructose, just now I told you, since it is a sugar soluble in water, it will be phosphorylated first to prevent its circulation back. So fructose 1-phosphate is produced. This fructose 1-phosphate splits up in the presence of aldolase B. and it forms glyceraldehyde and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. This glyceraldehyde, obviously, it will merge itself into glycolysis, and DHAP, dihydroxyacetone phosphate, will also merge itself into glycolysis, because these two are actually linked as isomers with respect to one another in the presence of triose phosphate isomerase. Deficiency of fructokinase leads to essential fructosuria. And hereditary fructose intolerance is caused by the deficiency of aldolase B. Is it clear? And if you look at the option, it is aldolase A. So if we see the answer, the answer to this question would be that both assertion and reasons are independently incorrect statements. Is it clear? Then we come over to second question. Benedict's test is positive in alkaptonuria and pentoses are excreted in alkaptonuria. Now again, when this type of question is there, first of all, you have to see what do you mean by this alkaptonuria. Now alkaptonuria is due to the deficiency of enzyme homogenistic acid oxidase. This enzyme converts homogenistic acid into methyl acetoacetate. Now, if this enzyme is deficient, what will happen? There will be accumulation of homogenistic acid is, and this homogenistic acid will be diverted or it will be excreted in urine. And this homogenistic acid, because the main feature of this is urine turns black or brown on exposure to air, or you can say on oxidation or on standing. So what happens is this homogenistic acid undergoes oxidation to form alkapton type of substance. So there is excretion of alkaptons in urine, which is also known as alkaptonuria. Right. Now, pentoses is never excreted in alkaptonuria. Never. Is it clear? And if we look at the basic characteristics of this alkaptonuria, one is color of the urine changes on standing to brown or dark. Urine gives a positive test with ferric chloride and silver nitrate. And alkapton deposition takes place, resulting in ochronosis. And one very important feature about this is that Benedict's test is positive with homogenistic acid. Homogenistic acid is actually getting reacted with Benedict's test. And pentoses is never excreted in alkaptonuria. So if you look at the answers, so A is true, assertion is true, but reason is false. Right? Then we come over to the next question. Rearrange the following urea cycle intermediates. Very, very important. Always remember, a question on urea cycle is bound to come, whether it is about the rate limiting steps, whether it is about the site of urea cycle, whether it is the energetics, or whether it is like this. So if we have to study urea cycle, you should know where urea cycle takes place. So urea cycle takes place in the liver. It has five steps, right? First step is what? Carbon dioxide or bicarbonate ions combine with the ammonia, which is coming from the amino acids, forming carbamoyl phosphate. In the presence of enzyme CPS1. And NAG or N-acetyl glutamate is an allosteric modulator of this enzyme. Once this carbamoyl phosphate is produced, it combines with ornithine to form citrulline. The enzyme is ornithine transcarbamylase. This citrulline then combines with aspartic acid forming arginosuccinate. This arginosuccinate undergoes splitting to give out fumaric acid to be converted into what? Arginine. And this arginine is converted into ornithine, giving urea on one hand in the presence of enzyme arginase. Here the enzyme is arginosuccinate synthetase. And wherever synthetase is required, always remember ATP is there. AMP plus PPI. And here it is splitting, so it is arginosuccinase. Now see, there are so many important points regarding this urea cycle here. First of all, first and second step are there in the mitochondria. Third, fourth and fifth occur in the cytosol. CPS1 is the rate limiting enzyme of mitochondria, of urea cycle as well. And this fumaric acid is a link to TCA cycle. This is again a very important question. In fact, all the questions, all the points which I have discussed here are very, very important. Now, urea cycle cannot be operative in the brain and kidney because brain lacks this enzyme and kidney lacks this enzyme. Right. Now, the question says what we have to do is we have to find the order. So, yahan pe you can see, let's quickly go through this thing. First of all, this carbamoyl phosphate is produced. Then, ornithine is combining with this, forming citrulline. This citrulline forms arginosuccinate. It forms arginine and in the end, ornithine is produced. So, if we look at the options, it would be C, E, B, A, and D. So this will be the correct answer. And this is how you have to attempt your question. Is it clear to all of you? Then we come over to question number 4. Again, assertion and reason based. Folic acid deficiency can be diagnosed by Figlu excretion test. It is correct. An accumulation of N-formaminoglutamic acid is due to the increased catabolism of urokinic acid. It is also correct. So the option would be both A and R are true and R is the correct explanation of A. Now see what happens here is, if we talk about Figlu, what happens is this is due to the degradation of this histidine. This histidine actually gets converted into urokinate or urokinic acid. This urokinic acid then forms what? Glutamic acid. And this formaminoglutamic acid in the presence of folic acid. Folic acid is required for this reaction and it will be converted into glutamate, and this glutamate then will be converted into alpha ketoglutarate. So this is how the reaction is going. What happens is, if folic acid is deficient, obviously Figlu will be excreted in urine. So folic acid deficiency can be diagnosed by the excretion of this Figlu, which is 4-iminoglutamic acid in urine. And this is actually due to the increased catabolism of urokinic acid, because urokinic acid is the one which is being converted into this. And this is again tested by histidine load test also. Histidine load test. So you can say both assertion and reason are correct for this particular question. Then next, a 40-year-old woman with progressive palpoplantar pigmentation, X-ray spine shows calcification of intervertebral disc. Now, whenever these clinical history type questions are asked, what you have to do is you have to pick up one point which is actually the correct answer of that. Now see, it is showing what calcification of the disc. And when we add Benedict's reagent to the urine, it is giving this greenish-brown or blue-black supernatant fluid. So what is there? This is a typical case of alkaptonuria. Onchronosis is there. Because I told you, alkapton or homogenistic acid gives a positive Benedict's test. So the answer will be alkaptonuria. Phenylketonuria is due to the deficiency of an enzyme phenylalanine hydroxylase. Again, a very important question. Hydroxylase, which converts phenylalanine to tyrosine. Arginosuccinic aciduria is the enzyme of urea cycle, which we have just discussed, leading to hyperammonemia. Albinism is due to the deficiency of tyrosinase, because tyrosine is required for the synthesis of melanin. So the answer to this question is alkaptonuria. Then we come over to, this is again a very important question which can be asked. Different peculiar odors in the body fluid or urine, and you have to just remember the name of the deficient enzyme. So here the question is, sweaty feet odor in body fluids occur due to the deficiency of what? Now, sweaty feet odor is a characteristic feature of isovaleric acidemia, which is actually due to the catabolism of branch chain amino acids. So the answer to this question would be FAD linked, because this reaction is FAD linked. The enzyme is isovalerate dehydrogenase. Isovalerate dehydrogenase. Right? Now, see, I have given this slide also. This slide again you have to mug up, because this question is expected again. A very important question. You can see, if the rotting fish smell comes, it is trimethylaminuria. If the urine starts giving the smell of boiled cabbage or rancid butter, it is tyrosinemia. If it gives maple syrup, it is maple syrup urine disease, which is due to the branch chain amino acids. If it gives tomcat urine, it is multiple carboxylase deficiency due to biotin, because biotin is required for carboxylation. Then sweaty feet is due to isovaleric acidemia, which is asked in the question, and boiled cabbage again, hypermethylaminemia. So these are some of the disorders which gives this peculiar or characteristic odor to the urine. Then another important question, ribozymes has the following catalytic activity. Now, you know all enzymes are proteins except ribozyme. And it is clear from the word itself, ribozyme means ribo or RNA has a catalytic activity. Now, if you see all the reactions, to be very precise, tRNA has a catalytic activity. And the most important activity present in tRNA is peptidyl transferase, the enzyme of translation. See, basically, whatever is the name of the enzyme, the function is like that, peptidyl, transfer of peptide group. If we say peptidases, it is digesting the peptide bond. If we say amino acyl tRNA synthetase, it is the fidelity enzyme of translation, because it is catalyzing, yeah, it is activating the amino acids. And GTPase, it is hydrolyzing, yeah, splitting GTP. So the answer to this question is peptidyl transferase, because what happens is, the mRNA is lying here. It has two sites, P site and A site. This is the ribosome which is undergoing translation. This is messenger RNA. And transfer RNA is the one which is carrying the respective amino acid. So obviously, translation mein we have to synthesize an entire polypeptide chain. So how this polypeptide chain is produced is when one amino acid combines with another amino acid by a peptide bond. So transfer translocation is also a part of this process, which is catalyzed by ribozyme. So the answer to this is peptidyl transferase. Then another important question, which of the following is not a post-transcriptional modification of RNA? Very, very important question. This can be asked. Basically, what happens is the RNA so produced, it is known as hnRNA. This hnRNA has to undergo modifications to form mRNA. Since the process is after transcription, so we call it as post-translational transcriptional modification. Because this hnRNA has exons as well as introns. These introns need to be removed. So mRNA has only the exons or the coding sequences. So for this, the three important steps are 5' capping, 3' tailing, so that it can protect it from the attack of other nucleases. And then this is the intron, splicing, forming the spliceosome. So what we get is, we get a messenger RNA. The process is splicing. So let's see the options. Splicing is there. 5' capping is there by poly-G. And the enzyme is guanosyl methyl transferase. Tailing, poly-A is added. Glycosylation is not. Glycosylation is simply attachment of a carbohydrate, which is not a part of post-transcriptional modification. It is post-translational modification when the polypeptide has to undergo, it has to be released. Then coenzyme for glycogen phosphorylase. Again, a very important question. Again, this question was asked in All India 3 years back. Coenzyme for glycogen phosphorylase is pyridoxal phosphate, which is also known as vitamin B6 pyridoxin. And this glycogen phosphorylase is a rate limiting enzyme for glycogenolysis. Present in two forms, active and inactive. Glucagon promotes this enzyme, glucagon and catecholamines, and insulin deactivates this enzyme. So PLP is the answer. Then the reason for ketosis in Wong-Gierkes disease are all except. Now, first of all, you should know, what do you mean by this Wong-Gierkes disease? It is actually glycogen storage disorder. And the deficient enzyme here is glucose 6-phosphatase. Now see, if we see what happens is, biochemically, if we see, this is glucose 6-phosphate, it is forming glucose, right? The enzyme is absent. What will happen? Increased concentration of glucose 6-phosphate will be there. So first is glucose concentration will decrease. So hypoglycemia will be there. Now this glucose 6-phosphate will be diverted to form more and more of pyruvic acid, which will form more and more of acetyl coenzyme A, which will be diverted, or which will undergo TCA cycle, and excess will be converted into ketone bodies. Right. This glucose 6-phosphate will undergo HMP shunt, forming ribose sugar, forming purines, uric acid, so leading to hyperuricemia also, leading to ketosis also. This will be the biochemical evaluation in Wong-Gierkes disease. Now what the question says, see, hypoglycemia will be there. Oxaloacetic acid is required for gluconeogenesis, yes, because hypoglycemia is there. If hypoglycemia is there, we require energy. That energy will come from gluconeogenesis, which actually plays an important role during starvation only. So oxaloacetic acid will be required there. Low blood glucose level less than, yes, it will also be there because it is hypoglycemia. Fatty acid mobilization will be more. It won't be less. ठीक है, सो दिस इज द आंसर व्हाई इट वुड बी मोर, बिकॉज इट इज प्रिटी एविडेंट फ्रॉम दिस रिएक्शन ओनली कि एसिटाइल कोएंजाइम इज फॉर्मिंग मोर एंड मोर ऑफ दिस. सो मोबिलाइजेशन, बिकॉज एनर्जी इज देयर एंड मोर मोबिलाइजेशन, फैटी एसिड विल बी कन्वर्टेड इन टू दिस बिकॉज द बॉडी रिक्वायर्स एनर्जी. तो इंस्टेंटेनियस सोर्स ऑफ एनर्जी इज बीटा ऑक्सीडेशन लीडिंग टू इंक्रीज कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ एसिटाइल कोएंजाइम लीडिंग टू कीटोसिस. So the answer would be fatty acid mobilization will be low. It will be more. Then during exercise, most rapid way to synthesize ATP. Very simple question and very important again. It is this phosphocreatine which is also known as phosphagen system. Phosphagen system of energy. Basically what happens is this creatine, which is considered to be the energy reservoir of the muscle, this creatine in the presence of CPK enzyme forms creatine phosphate, which gives energy for muscle relaxation as well as contraction. So during exercise, phosphocreatine will be there. Then comes glycogenolysis. The first would be phosphagen system. Then lactic acidosis in thymine deficiency is due to which dysfunction? Now, if we look at this question, see what happens is lactic acidosis, increased concentration of lactic acid is there. That means the enzyme is PDH. PDH, which is an example of multi-enzyme complex. Or the reaction is what? What happens is this pyruvic acid, which is being produced from glycolysis, it is converted to acetyl coenzyme A. For this, this PDH is required. This is in the presence of oxygen, obviously, because this is oxidative decarboxylation. And TPP or thymine pyrophosphate is the major coenzyme required for that, because this is the one which takes out this carbon dioxide. Now, if this PDH is absent, what will happen? This pyruvic acid won't be converted into acetyl coenzyme A and it will be diverted to form more and more of lactic acid. So, lactic acidosis is a characteristic feature of deficiency of PDH. Is it clear? Pep carboxylase is the enzyme of gluconeogenesis. This is again very important. This is the enzyme which is present in the mitochondria. Or this is the only enzyme of gluconeogenesis which is present in the mitochondria. Pyruvate carboxylase. This is again an enzyme of gluconeogenesis. Basically, actually what happens is if you look at these enzymes, and aldolase is of glycolysis, if we talk about the occurrence, this pyruvate carboxylase is present in the mitochondria, not PEP carboxylase. It should be PEP carboxykinase, if you remember. PEP carboxykinase is present in the cytosol, but pyruvate carboxylase is present in the mitochondria because this is the first step of gluconeogenesis in which pyruvic acid forms oxaloacetic acid. This oxaloacetic acid comes out of the mitochondria, forms malic acid. Then, because oxaloacetic acid is impermeable to mitochondrial membrane, so it will be converted into malic acid here. Chalo, I'll write the reaction rate here. And this malic acid will be transported outside, where it will be converted back to oxaloacetic acid and which forms PEP. This is how it goes. Write it like this. This is in the mitochondria and this is in the cytosol. Means pyruvic acid is already in the mitochondria. It forms oxaloacetic acid. Oxaloacetic acid being impermeable to mitochondrial membrane forms malic acid. This malic acid is transported outside the cytoplasm where it forms oxaloacetic acid and which finally forms PEP by this carboxykinase. So PEP carboxykinase is present in the cytosol. Pyruvate carboxylase is present in the mitochondria. But the answer to this question is obviously PDH. This we have already discussed here. And this is important and this is an expected question also. Then a patient has normal blood glucose level as estimated by glucose oxidase per oxidase method shows positive Benedict's test. Which of the following is likely to cause? A very important question, a very interesting question. Now see, normal blood glucose level. as estimated by GOD-POD test. But it shows positive Benedict's test. That means it is a reducing sugar. Understood? Out of the three options, if we see, fructose and glucose and galactose are both the reducing sugars. Is it clear? Now here, two options can be there, fructosemia and galactosemia. If we see, most likely it is galactosemia. Why? Because galactosemia is due to the deficiency of galactose 1-phosphate uridyl transferase. And actually, this galactosemia is characterized by increased concentration of galactose in urine. But if we talk about fructosemia, it is not fructosuria. Fructose appears in urine only during fructosuria, but here it is written fructosemia. And moreover, if we see fructosuria, it is due to the deficiency of enzyme fructokinase. And overall, वैसे भी if we see fructosuria is not possible in a sense that कि fructose has no renal threshold for this, so it will not be excreted. And if you look at the metabolism also, fructose undergoes metabolism first because it is bypassing one step. When glucose is being converted to glucose 6-phosphate, glucose 6-phosphate is converted to fructose 6-phosphate. So we can say that even in essential fructosuria and hereditary fructose intolerance, fructosemia is unlikely because fructose has no renal threshold and fructose can be metabolized by hexokinase even in the absence of fructokinase or aldolase B. So the answer is galactosemia. Then a 47-year-old boy with compulsive self-mutilation, intellectual disability, is always strapped to bed serum uric. See, again, the answer to this question is HGPRT. Why? Because you can see there is hyperuricemia. There is, you can say, joints, swelling in the joints. And this is actually Leish-Nahan syndrome, which is due to the deficiency of this HGPRT enzyme, mainly in males. Self-mutilation is there. Obviously, intellectual disability is there. The person is mentally retarded also, because here it is written self-mutilation. Self-mutilation is a characteristic feature of Leish-Nahan syndrome. The person has an urge to bite his toes, fingers. So the answer is this. Rest, if we look at other enzymes, PRPP synthetase, hyperuricemia, xanthine oxidase, again uric acid, and glucose 6-phosphatase is altogether a different enzyme which is converting glucose 6-phosphate to glucose. So the answer is HGPRT. Again, a very important question can be asked in the exam. Then what is the biochemical defect in the Jueglar syndrome? Now, Jueglar syndrome is actually due to the deficiency of peroxisomes. Always remember, peroxisomes are the site for beta oxidation of very long chain fatty acids. Very long chain fatty acids undergo oxidation in peroxisomes, where it results into the formation of one molecule of octanoyl CoA and one molecule of acetyl coenzyme A. Now, if peroxisomes are deficient, there will be infiltration of very long chain fatty acids, leading to what? Accumulation of these very long chain fatty acids. That is why this Jueglar syndrome is also known as cerebrohepatorenal syndrome. Again, a very important question. So the answer to this is peroxisomal biogenesis disorder. Right. So then we come over to the last slide, which is very important again. This is actually, you have to mug up certain points in biochemistry. So before going to appear for an exam, you should quickly go through this slide. I must say that I will suggest you this because rate limiting enzymes is the most important question which is generally asked. Because biochemistry, if we see, what is it? The type of questions asked on it are basically about the rate limiting enzymes, basically about the energetics, and some questions are from molecular biology. So this is a very important slide. Just say for glycolysis, the rate limiting enzyme is PFK or it can be PFK1. Glycogen synthesis, synthase. Glycogenolysis, it is phosphorylase. TCA cycle, it is ICD or isocitrate dehydrogenase. Fatty acid synthesis or lipogenesis, it is acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase. Cholesterol synthesis, HMG-CoA reductase, again very important. Bile acid synthesis, 7-alpha hydroxylase, again very important. Urea cycle, CPS1, very important. And ketogenesis, HMG-CoA synthase. So this is a list of rate-limiting enzymes of these processes. Right? So this is just a small effort from my side so that you can just quickly revise whatever can be asked in the exam. So all the best for your exam tomorrow. Do well. Thanks a lot. Take care.